Hello, I'm Bart McGeehon, one of the production managers here for the AT&T Performing Arts Center, and I'll be leading today's Tech Talk, part of our Backstage Spotlight Arts Education Program. And while we usually prefer bringing students here to the center, we are taking these classes online so you can experience our technical theater training programs from home. Today, we're going to be talking about rigging with three of the center's riggers. Pat Keller, our lead flyman for the Windspear Opera House, Adam Bowlin, our rigging manager for the center, and Tim Callahan, the head carpenter for the Windspear Opera House. Each member of the team will talk about a different type of rigging that we have in each of our systems here at the center. First, let's talk to Pat Keller, our lead flyman, who will talk to us about our traditional counterweight system that we have in the Windspear Opera House. Welcome, Pat. Thanks for joining us today.
Hi, thanks for having me.
Great to have you. Pat's got a lot of experience, so I'm going to let him talk a little bit about what is a counterweight system. Tell us, Pat.
Well, first of all, a counterweight system in theaters is basically set up. It's like a giant, almost like a giant seesaw. It's a balancing system. You have the side that the weights go on, which is called the arbor, and then there's cables that run all the way up to the ceiling and up above that, and then goes over and then drops down and supports a pipe. We have a double pipe on ours with a capacity of 2,000 pounds. So when I've got that pipe in, which is in close to the deck, and people are loading it with either electrics or soft goods or scenic elements or even speakers sometimes, whatever that weighs, which is on the pipe, has to be counterweighted, hence the word counterweight system. So if I've got, say, 1,000 pounds worth of lights and scenic elements on the pipe, I have to have guys over on, I have a crew that's all the way up near the ceiling, and they load the arbor. And they load the arbor. If I have 1,000 pounds here, I need 1,000 pounds here. So they will be in balance, just like someone on a seesaw. If they're at the same size and they're sitting in the same place on a seesaw, they're in balance.
How long does it typically take to get something in balance?
Oh, just a few minutes. I usually have two people working up high and what we call the loading gallery. And the loading gallery is an area that they have access to the arbor. So when the system pipe is flown in, the arbor is all the way out. And there's actually almost a sidewalk up there with chains and everything for safety. And the people load bricks there. And the bricks in my facility is 20-pound bricks and also 40-pound bricks.
So if I have to put 1,000 pounds, that's a lot of bricks.
That's a bunch of bricks. Yes, it is.
So that's a lot of work.
Yes, it is, and it's not for the real weak. That part of it there is that part of it's it takes some strength and some durability, because sometimes we will use 60 or 70 different line sets, so they have to weight that for me on each and every one of them.
So each one has to be done for every pipe that you use. You have to go up and weight it to the weight of what's on the pipe.
Exactly. That's exactly what happened.
Now let's talk to Adam Bowlin, our rigging manager, about our automated line sets in the Wiley Theater. Thanks, Adam. Thanks for joining us today on Backstage Spotlight. So tell us just in a nutshell, what's the main difference in what we just learned about our traditional counterweight and an automated system?
Well, honestly, Bart, the biggest difference in an automated system is in that a automated system does not have a counterweight system or the entire arbor pit. It consists of an electric motor that pulls with enough force through a gearbox to make up for that counterweighting system. So an automated line set can pull up to 1,200 pounds a piece without having all that 1,200 pounds in stage weight hanging over the stage or guided by all those ropes. So it takes away a lot of that inherent danger.
It also takes away a lot of work, too.
It does, but it also comes with its own problems. It's a lot more maintenance involved. Things are a lot more particular and finite, very meticulous in things that have to be set just right in order to make sure that they are just as safe as a counterweight system that isn't going to run away if a motor brake fails or something, you know, mechanical like that fails. It's more of a balanced system that isn't just going to take off on you.
So what are the benefits of going with a automated system?
One of the biggest benefits with going with an automated system is, especially when in our newer shows these days, when a lot more scenery and a lot more drops are flying in and out past each other, you get a lot finer control over where those drops start and stop, because a mechanical system can be repeated to that function in a very finite amount versus having a human do it. We're only human. We have a certain variable to that, and that drop might start or stop a little faster or take a little longer or land a little harder or softer. With the machinery, you can program it to be exactly what you need it every time. So it flies in that exact same time, or it lands to that exact same mark every time, repeatable without fail.
How does an automated system help with labor costs?
Helps immensely in labor costs. Now, it does depend on the system to how many line sets you can move at the same time. But take, for instance, our Wiley Theater. I have 48 line sets, but out of those line sets, I can move 8 at any given point in time at the same time on the same cue, one person pushing one button.
Instead of 8 people pulling 8 ropes.
Correct.
So once you have your computer programmed, it really cuts down on the amount of labor. What are the disadvantages of a system like this?
Well, one of the big disadvantages is a lot of mechanical and electrical pieces involved. And any given point in time, you can have an electrical component fail. And depending on what fails, you could lose a certain part of a show, or you could lose the entire ability to move anything in that show for any given amount of time so you can get that repair done.
So, like your hard drive crashes, you don't have a show.
Exactly.
Finally, let's chat with Tim Callahan, our head carpenter at the Windspear Opera House, about automated motors and how those are currently being used in shows. We've talked to Patman about a counterweight system. We've talked to Adam about an electronic automated line set system. But what we want to talk to you about is, what do we do when we talk about automated motors and how those work? So my question is, first of all, why would someone want to use motors when we already have a counterweight system in our theater?
So when a show decides to use motors, number one, it's a lot quicker than having to send 2 people up to load an arbor and hang individual lamps. You can come in on the truss system and everything's already in the truss. So all you do is hang the motor and snap in. And also, the benefits of running through chain motors is you can hang wherever you want.
Adam was talking to us about automated line sets. Do we have any of those in the Windspear?
No, we do not.
How much weight can a motor take?
The motors that we have in-house themselves, we have a 1-ton motor that can hold 2,000 pounds. We have a 1/4-ton motor that will hold 500 pounds. There are also motors that are called half-ton motors that, just do the math, is 1,000 pounds.
So as we were talking about in our counterweight system, everything runs off of a single line that's level. What about on a motorized system and with individual motors? Can we make things that are not level?
When you go to move a truss, it is never level. So the object is to level, you go to your height and you level the truss to where you want it. Every motor is going to run at a different speed. It will say 16 feet per minute, 32 feet per minute. But unless it's controlled by an automated board, you are always going to move unlevel. Can pieces move unlevel? Yes. You can put a truss at a 45-degree angle as long as you did the math and you know that the truss is capable of holding that weight.
So when we go to like a rock and roll concert or something like that and we see a giant circle in the air, that's probably supported by multiple motors.
Correct. On a circular truss, you should have three motors, but it is creating a force between the three motors. So most of the time you will not see a circular truss move.
So when we were talking with Patman, he was saying that some of the shows require up to eight people to fly eight separate line sets. Adam was saying that in the Wiley Theater, one person can hit a button and eight line sets move at the same time. What if we wanted eight motors to move at the same time? Would that take eight different people? Or is there a way to control all the motors from one place?
You can control from a pendant. It's an eight-way pendant that is plugged in.
Thanks, guys. One other thing that riggers have to be aware of is how to tie knots. In this section, we're going to teach you how to tie three different kinds of knots that our riggers use every single day. Every kind of knot. Our friends at Animated Knots are allowing us to use their videos to help you learn how to tie the three knots. The first knot we're going to learn to tie is the clove hitch.
This video teaches you how to tie the clove hitch using the end of the rope. Pass the end of the rope around the pole, continue across the standing end and around the pole a second time, thread the end under itself, and pull tight to form the clove hitch. For more information about this knot and many others, and to learn about our mobile apps, please visit animatedknots.com.
This next video teaches you how to tie the prussic knot.
Use a piece of cord formed into a loop. Pass the knot around the rope three times inside the loop. Make sure the turns lie neatly beside each other and pull the knot tight. For more information about this knot and many others, and to learn about our mobile apps, please visit animatedknots.com.
This last video teaches you how to tie the bowline.
Form a small loop in the rope, leaving a long enough tail to make the bowline that you need. Pass the tail of the rope through the loop as though making an overhand knot. Continue around the standing end, and then pass the tail back through the small loop to complete the knot. For more information about this knot and many others, and to learn about our mobile apps, please visit animatedknots.com.
We certainly want to thank our friends at Animated Knots for allowing us to use their videos to help you learn how to tie these knots. That's it for today's segment of Backstage Spotlight's Tech Talk. We want to thank all the foundations and donors who make the Center's arts education programs possible. We couldn't do this without you. If you'd like to help the Center offer more programs like this, please visit our website at attpac.org/support. I'm Bart McGeehon at the AT&T Performing Arts Center, yours to discover.